It's a pleasure to be with you, Ms. Shomona Khanna, counsel in the Supreme Court and in other courts of the country, particularly as an expert on the Forest Rights Act. Ma'am, I just wanted to ask you particularly about recent developments. February 2019 sort of generated shockwaves across the Adivasi tribal and the forest dweller community because of the Supreme Court order that suddenly said that mass-scale evictions of 14 million people take place. Would you just comment on that? Okay. How did it lead up to there? What has been the trajectory of the case?
Okay, so when the Forest Rights Act actually came into force, that was in December 2007, within a month of the act coming into force, there were a series of writ petitions filed across the country in the Supreme Court and in different high courts challenging the constitutional validity of the act. Most of these petitions have been filed by certain wildlife conservation organizations who have consistently taken a stand that to conserve forests and wildlife, a fortress conservation approach is required. And the other category of petitioners in these cases are retired forest officers associations who represent, in a sense, the existing forest bureaucracy of the country. So these two categories of people mainly came before the court challenging the constitutional validity of the act as a whole. And over a fairly long period of time, attempts were made to get the implementation of the Forest Rights Act stayed or maybe stopped by the court, or maybe fragmented in some ways, but those attempts didn't happen. So now the interesting thing that has happened is that all these petitions pending before the Supreme Court, although the main question and the only question before the court is whether the Forest Rights Act is constitutionally valid, there has been an attempt to divert the attention of the court to the issue of rejected claims. And in 13 years of implementation of the Forest Rights Act, naturally, there have been a number of claims filed. There have been a number of claims that have been approved. There are a number of claims that are still remaining to be approved. They're still pending consideration. But the focus of the court has been brought to this number of rejected claims. And the court has somehow been convinced that simply by the fact that a case had been rejected under the Forest Rights Act, it automatically means that there is an encroachment and therefore automatically means that there should be an eviction of that forest dweller. This kind of legal reasoning is completely fallacious and is not supported by any kind of documentation or any kind of written argumentation by the petitioners. Simply on the basis of oral arguments made by them and submissions made in the court had accepted this submission and passed eviction orders. Fortunately, on the 28th of February, the court did put its order of evictions on hold, and for the time being, evictions of forest dwellers across the country have been put on hold until further orders of the court.
The next date is July 24th.
Yes.
Some state governments have filed their affidavits. Other state governments will file their affidavits on this narrow question of evictions, and the whole matter has been narrowed down to this question. Whereas in Telangana, etc., we are already starting seeing stories about some people being evicted, quote-unquote, be evicted, despite the stay order of the Supreme Court.
Hmm.
In this background, ma'am, I wanted to ask you is the Forest Rights Act with its intent being really understood by the courts and by lawyers and by governments?
The Forest Rights Act has emerged out of several decades, if not more, of people's movements. Tribal rights movements, Adivasi movements, movements in for forest dwellers' rights, and also movements for protection of the environment. And a very, very important aspect of the Forest Rights Act is that it recognizes what is now considered to be international best practice, which is the symbiotic and integrated relationship between indigenous peoples and the forests. And across the world, both under the aegis of the United Nations and a large number of international conservation organizations. The world is moving towards a recognition of the fact that you cannot conserve the environment, you cannot preserve the biodiversity without indigenous people's active collaboration, because there are vast troves of indigenous knowledge and ancient knowledge which we need to make use of and we need to harness to be able to protect our environment for future generations, and in fact to protect our environment at all. Unfortunately, there is a tendency in India to move in the opposite direction, and the existing colonial and post-colonial laws relating to forest and environment are focused on treating indigenous communities, forest dwellers, Adivasis and tribals as interlopers, as encroachers on the forest, as people who need to be gotten rid of so that the forest can be protected. This is completely unscientific and completely anachronistic, and this approach needs to be done away with for once and for all in our country. The 2006 Forest Rights Act actually makes a move in the right direction by recognizing this symbiotic relationship, and in the preamble actually states that the forest dwellers are an integral part of the forest ecosystem, and the forests and forest dwellers must go together into the future. That's one thing. Then looking at the past, you know, the Forest Rights Act recognizes that there has been a historical injustice against the forest dwellers. It's a very, very unique law in that sense. I think in India, for the first time, there's a recognition by Parliament through a statement in the preamble, recognizing that there is this particular marginalized community to which we as a nation have done wrong. And that is something that we as a nation now want to correct. And if one looks at it, there have been many, many attempts, even in the Supreme Court and in other courts, inside the executive, outside the executive, to address the historical injustice against Adivasis. The fact that forest laws were legislated by the colonial government and even after independence without recognizing their pre-existing and ancient traditional rights. These attempts did not go very far because there wasn't perhaps enough political will, or the laws or executive instructions through which they came were not strong enough to meet the clash with the mainstream forest laws at that point of time. The Forest Rights Act has that kind of heft. It has internally mechanisms to protect it, including non-substantive clauses in key provisions of the Act.
Can you explain that?
So, for instance, if you look at Section 4.1, which is the actually at the heart of the law, it is the vesting clause and says that Parliament hereby vests forest rights in forest dwellers, scheduled tribes and other traditional forest dwellers. In that provision, it begins with a non-obstantic clause which says notwithstanding any other law for the time being in force. So the vesting clause, which substantively vests rights in forest dwellers and makes this paradigm shift, is preceded by this non-obstantic clause overriding all other existing forest and other legislations, and to some extent also overriding some of the decisions of the Supreme Court that came out in the Godavarman case. Fortunately for us, previous orders and decisions of the Supreme Court, both in the Godavarman case and in the Niyamgiri case, have been very supportive of the Forest Rights Act. We have a developing jurisprudence from the Supreme Court and different high courts, which is supportive of the Forest Rights Act. And it's a body of judicial precedent that needs to be brought more to the forefront. And for people across the country and also judges across the country, lawyers who are working on these issues, to recognize that there is this jurisprudence developing. One of the cases, for instance, relates to the Niyamgiri case, where a 3-judge bench of the Supreme Court, after laying out the entire constitutional and historical background of the Forest Rights Act, not only approved what the Forest Rights Act says and sets out to do, but also interpreted Section 5 of the Forest Rights Act to say that unless there is active decision making and participation of the local Gram Sabhas, no forest land can be diverted for non-forest purposes. So this is a very creative interpretation and a very, very important interpretation. So today I feel that there is a need to also bring these judicial precedents, these developments before the court and also inform the court about the fact that the Forest Rights Act isn't simply a legislation like another legislation, but it is a very, very important historical moment for the indigenous peoples of this country, and is also, in fact, to tell you the truth, it's also a beacon of light and hope for countries in the region. So in the South Asian region, in the Southeast Asian region, a number of countries are drawing inspiration from the Forest Rights Act and trying to draft laws which are similar for their own countries. So this is an important law, and I think it's important to understand both the present, the past, and also the future that it represents.
And then you said very correctly that the Section 41 is the heart of the Act, because it actually says that any other law. So that brings me to my next question, that we find in India that many such liberative or emancipatory or recognition of rights laws actually get stymied or caught up in the fact that there are multiple legislations which actually contravene them, which should have been repealed. How does this apply here?
In fact, this is causing a lot of problems on the ground. For instance,
you used a term like circling of...
circling of the wagons, yeah. So one of the very, very big problems that the Forest Rights Act is facing, and it's something that we had anticipated that it would face, is that the Forest Rights Act represents a paradigm shift in terms of governance mechanisms at the ground level, where until now, for well over 150 years, it has been the state forest departments which have been the be-all and the end-all of what happens inside the forest. And today there is a shift in decision making, in power, and the power dynamics are shifting on the ground in very, very significant ways. And obviously there has been a pushback from the status quo to this. So what we have seen is that not only is there an increased emphasis on pre-existing laws which have a colonial history, such as the Indian Forest Act of 1927, the Wildlife Conservation Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, and so on, but we are seeing new legislations and new executive instructions coming in, which are in a sense either ignoring the Forest Rights Act or belittling it. One of the legislations that, for instance, came out a couple of years ago was the Compensatory Afforestation Fund Act. Now, this is a huge fund which today stands at something to the tune of 56,000 crores, which is supposed to be spent on compensatory afforestation for lands which have been diverted for non-forest purpose. And because it doesn't actually have any acknowledgement of the fact that local Gram Sabhas should be consulted on how these so-called compensatory forests are to be developed, the result of that is that a large number of communities are now confronted with a double whammy. First, they were displaced when their forests were diverted for some non-forest purpose, which could be a mining project, or it could have been a cement plant, or whatever, steel factory, or whatever it is. So at that point of time, they were displaced from their lands, And very often, because the rights recognition process under the Forest Rights Act has been so faulty, so very often people have been displaced without their rights having been recognized, without receiving proper compensation. Thereafter, the compensatory afforestation that is being done, because there is, in a country of our size with our population density, there is no land surplus, right? So forest departments are coming in and doing compensatory afforestation either on common lands or on lands that have been assigned to forest dwellers. And let me tell you that the tragedy is that very often it is the lands of the most vulnerable which are selected for these kind of forcible plantations. So we have cases coming in from places like Orissa, where forest departments have come and overnight done plantations on the lands of particularly vulnerable tribal groups, who they very well know that these groups do not have any recourse to the justice system. They will not be able to file criminal cases. They will not be able to get any remedy in the court. And all they'll have to do is they'll just have to then go back into the forest and go back into their pre-agricultural lifestyles. It's extremely unfortunate that this is happening under the aegis of a law enacted by Parliament and with a great deal of push from the Central Ministry of Environment and even to some extent by the Supreme Court itself and under, of course, the power of 53,000 crore rupees of money. So that's one thing that has happened. The other process that is happening, which is causing a lot of concern, in 2016 and then again in 2018, the central government attempted to amend the 1988 forest policy and bring in a forest policy which would sideline the forest dwellers and indigenous peoples and allow private entities to participate in forest management. Now, this is a complete anathema to the kind of forest management that has happened in our country. There's a whole body of judicial precedent, the 1988 forest policy. There is no space for private corporate participation in forest management in our country. It is not the kind of resource in which you can allow private participation. But the forest ministry seems to be quite adamant about it. And now in 2019, early 2019, the ministry has released a so-called draft amendment to the 1927 Forest Act, which actually isn't an amendment. It simply replaces that legislation and goes back into some ancient and completely debunked method of forest management and control, which includes not just creation of production forests under the control conceivable control of private entities, but also enables and gives attempts to give powers of search, seizure, use of force up to the point of killing, the power to administer justice, the power to detain and keep in custody to the forest department. And the forest department across the country has never been trained as a police force. I mean, however faulty our police forces might be, they at least go through a minimum training procedure in what is procedure, what is the criminal procedure, what are the processes, what is due process. And there is an understanding. The procedures may be followed many times in the breach, but at least there is an understanding and there is a training process police officials go through. Forest department officials have absolutely no training in policing, but they are going to be given arms. They're going to be given the power to use those arms, and they are given immunity, which actually surpasses the immunity given to the armed forces under the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. So under AFSPA, where you need a prior sanction for prosecution, But once you receive the prior sanction, you can prosecute, right? Under this proposed amendment to the Indian Forest Act, not only would you require prior sanction, but you would also require an administrative inquiry to have reached a finding of misconduct. So that's an additional thing which even the armed forces don't have.
You're raising the bar, Chandya.
What kind of forest governance, environmental protection are we moving towards? The world is moving towards a place where indigenous communities, forest dwelling communities are treated as partners, even leaders in the tracing a path to a place where we can actually undo the damage climate change has done. And in our country, we seem to be moving back into the medieval times. I'm completely horrified by the draft of the Indian Forest Act amendment that I have read. And I feel that it's a draft that we cannot even begin to start any communication on. That entire draft needs to be rejected in its complete entirety.
So would you say, ma'am, in conclusion, thank you so much for your time, that this government, 2014 and onwards, I mean, there's always been a tussle between the Ministry of Environment and the Ministry of Tribal Affairs on this whole issue of who is the conservator of the environment, as you yourself put it. But do you think the matters have got sharpened and more hostile after 2014?
I think it's not so much the issues have become sharper. I think that prior to 2014, there was a certain openness and transparency with which the government worked. And there was an opportunity for civil society, for people from other political parties, for academics, for even people from social movements and grassroots movements to participate and to give their viewpoints on the kind of policy changes.
You yourself were an advisor.
Yes, I myself was an advisor to the Ministry of Tribal Affairs, and there was a very open channel of communication, and there were actually structural channels of communication for the government to receive any kind of inputs and even criticism if it was planning to take a certain step. And I definitely experienced the wealth the kind of criticism and inputs that you receive when you have this kind of open channel of communication. Yes, of course, it can lead to certain delays in decision making and so on. But then it also leads to a richness in the final decisions that are taken. And what I feel is that subsequent to 2014, these channels of communication, of transparency, have been closed down. And what we feel today is that there is a sense of constantly being caught unawares, constantly being caught off guard. For instance, the fact that such a detailed amendment to the Forest Act has been in the coming is something that came as a complete surprise to all of us who keep abreast of these issues. And it's certainly not, if you look at it, I think it's a 120-page long draft. So it's not something that has been drafted overnight. So it has been a long time in the making. But in that process of construction, there has been no space for communication. And even today, if you look at the document that is out in the public domain, it does not call for comments from the general public. It is calling for feedback from state governments and putting the onus on the state governments that if they want to seek inputs from civil society, they can do so. But directly in response to this draft, civil society actually does not have a space to respond. This, I think, is a very worrying development in a multi-issue, huge democracy with multiple issues and multiple stakeholders on multiple different levels, such as India. It's a real problem that the government is preferring to function in a non-transparent way.
Do you have any hopes in the Supreme Court post July 24th?
as a practicing lawyer, I always have hope in the Supreme Court. I do believe that there are certain gaps in presenting the true picture around the Forest Rights Act before the court. And I think that a lot has been said about the fact that the Ministry of Tribal Affairs, the Central Ministry of Tribal Affairs, did not represent its case in February. But there are also all the state governments and all the union territories of the country, that's 36 or 37 parties, which are party before the court, and they also did not speak. So I do feel that there is an opportunity for the state governments to place the true picture before the court. And the matter is definitely sub judice. All the questions are open, and there is a need to convince the court to not be sidetracked by this issue of rejections anymore, and come back to the core issue of constitutional validity of the Forest Rights Act. Hear the legal arguments on constitutional validity of the Forest Rights Act and come to a decision, and the judgment of the Supreme Court will be then available for everyone to see, and it will bring a quietus to all this insecurity and fragility that is resulting in all these developments taking place in a piecemeal manner.
Thank you so much.